National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Council spokesperson Mark Timbal and Social Welfare Department spokesperson Irene Dumlao. Irene, thank you for coming. Apologies for saying your name wrong earlier today. Mark, thank you so much for coming back to Head Start. All right, so, I mean, this is alarming because the quakes are right after the other of equal strength or even stronger. I know first, let's start with this. We don't have a FIVOX guest with us, but they must have given you some explanation first as you're both trying, you're trying to assess the damage.
Yes, what we have been informed by our colleagues in FIVOX is that the area of Tulunan is really experiencing a high level of seismic activity. It appears that the number of faults present in the area have shown activity, possibly because of the movement of one, causing pressure on the others.
So what they're saying, well, what they've told you is essentially the fault in Tulunan or the ground under Tulunan is essentially shifting, moving, that's causing these
earthquakes.
Earthquakes, though. They're like in consequence because they're not aftershocks anymore.
Yes.
All right. So what do we do then? Are you advising residents that it's not to live there? It's not safe to live in Tulunan for now?
Well, what we're saying to the residents of the area in Tulunan and the communities near the epicenter is that it's not safe to go inside buildings as of this point in time. What we're trying to avoid is that occurrence wherein there are people inside structures, another earthquake hits, and then the building collapses on them. We're advising them to stay in the open spaces, in the evacuation centers, and don't insist on going back, because usually what's happening is people who go back are the ones who get trapped.
No, but this is what I'm trying to say. How can your life go on? Because, right, it's not like a storm or a typhoon wherein you can track it and it's passed. This one, the FIVOX has said that there's something in Tulunan specifically that's happening. In other words, you can't predict an earthquake. You can't predict the next one. But then you have Christmas that's coming up. Are they supposed to live in the evacuation centers until Christmas, for example?
Hopefully, the stay in the evacuation centers will not be protracted or lengthened. But
no, but how do you know? That's the thing.
We cannot.
That's it. But what if two big earthquakes have happened 2 days after each other, that's what I'm trying to say. You have a 6.5, and the first one was 6.6. So these are not aftershocks where one just comes at 2 or 3. It's not that. They're of equal strength. Almost, yes. So how do we know that another one will come next week?
We can't. There is no prediction mechanism still, but what FIVOX is doing, as what we have understood it, is there are projections that the possibility of another earthquake is present.
So what? So my point is it safe to live in Tulunan?
Well, as of
as the NDRRMC, what have you... That's my point. Yeah. There's no way to predict, right? So is it safe to live in Tulunan if there were two big quakes that happened after the other?
It is still safe because earthquakes don't actually kill. What kills are the structures that collapse on people. Oh. Just as long as the people are in open spaces. But if the concern is how they will continue with their lives.
How will they be in open spaces all their lives?
There is, government is providing assistance for them to be able to bear the inconvenience of staying in evacuation centers, but it still falls within the decisioning of our citizens if they would want to go elsewhere.
So what is the protocol in Tulunan now? Tell us. Well, what is the protocol in Tulunan?
Well, people are not allowed to go back to buildings.
Okay.
They're advised to stay in open spaces or in the evacuation center. There are a number of people who are not going to the evacuation centers, but in fear of having their houses burglarized, they're staying in safe spaces just within close proximity to their houses. But they're not advised to go inside. They're just staying outside. That's why the SWD is sending more temporary shelters, tents, tarpaulins, so that this could be used by our evacuated citizens there.
Okay. Now, is the fault line, I mean, based on what FIVOX has told you, is it close? Is it under? Where is it exactly why Tulunan is affected this much?
what we have learned is that in the area, in the immediate vicinity of Tulunan, there are a number of faults.
Okay, so that's my thing. Is it even safe to live there if there are a lot of faults? In other words, when is it right to tell the residents, okay, there are a lot of faults here, you've seen a lot of movement, these are certain areas where there are no fault lines, perhaps we should all move activity there. That's what I'm driving at.
The only place in the Philippines that doesn't have a fault is in Palawan. Almost all sectors here in the archipelago have faults, which are capable of generating earthquakes. But what we can see here is that it's not going to shake every day for the entirety of our lives. But so in what's happening now is for this particular period, it's active. But once the energy stored in under land is dissipated because of the continuing earthquakes, it will stop.
Okay. So usually when does the NDRRMC ever give a protocol of some kind to say this area is not safe to live in? Has that ever happened?
Well, we have identified hazardous areas, which we have informed the local governments to ensure that these areas be vacated or evacuated at specific times. We are advising also local governments to make sure that some of these hazard areas should not be used as residential areas, like beside rivers or coastal areas that are prone to storm surges. The foothills of mountains that are prone to landslides are always advised to be cleared of residences. But we have to understand that there are a lot of people who've been living there for forever, and it's not easy to move these people out. What the government is doing is studying relocation strategies so that these people can be given incentives to go to safer places. But in cases of the earthquakes usually stop, and then it takes another 100 years maybe for it to be activated again.
All right. Irene, the DSWD has been on the ground. Can you give us an update?
Yes. As mentioned by Sir, we have, the DSWD is assisting the local government units in handling emergencies such as this, and of course in managing evacuation centers.
So what's the latest? Can you tell me the municipality exactly? How many people are you feeding?
Yes. As of 6 a.m. this morning, we have received reports that more than 6,000 families or more than 30,000 households and individuals are actually affected by
all
this earthquake. Regions 11 and 12.
Okay, specifically what in regions 11 and 12? Let's be specific.
Yeah, in region 11, we have Bansalan, City of Digos, and Magsaysay in Davao del Sur. And in region 12, particularly in North Cotabato, we have City of Kidapawan, Makilala, Mulang, and Tulunan, North Cotabato.
Okay. And where are the evacuation sites? They can't be in a school.
Most of the evacuation centers are in open spaces, some of which are in public schools. These are located also in Bansalan, City of Digos, and Magsaysay in Davao del Sur, and in the City of Kitabawan in North Cotabato.
Okay, so what are the biggest concerns right now? Is water affected, electricity, or are you just sending, for example, now it's food?
Yes, what we are sending right now are tents, laminated sacks, hygiene kits, plastic bottles for their as their water containers. We are also sending food packs. These are gender responsive and culturally sensitive food items that is being supplied to our to the affected households and families and individuals, I need to say. And we are also providing them tents as temporary shelter for those who were displaced from their current households.
So the the SOP for this, for example, you have the DSWD already giving tents, etc. But nobody wants to live in a tent for 2 weeks or 3 weeks or a month. So what is the advice? When can they go back to their homes, for example, given that we can't predict an earthquake in Tulunan happening again, right?
So for NDRMC, it's not advising anyone to go back to their houses
this
time. But what we're waiting for are indications, especially an advice from FEVOX, that this activity has already subsided. Once this has subsided, and we are assured that there are no more immediately succeeding emergencies of this nature.
No, but the point is they can't tell.
That's correct. That's correct.
Yun ang tanong ko. So, wala bang average protocol? Is it people reach after an earthquake of a 6.5? Do people go back to their homes 2 days after?
No,
is it 3 days after? A week after?
There is none. What is essential here is that we have to keep our people safe, even though they are forced to stay in open spaces. But we do not limit them from going to other places or their relatives so that they can find other places to stay.
But then not what happens the to their, I mean, to their daily lives? They do have to go to work.
That's correct. One of the difficulties usually encountered in these cases of emergency is a disruption of commercial activities in the area, as well as the livelihood. This is one of the items that are being studied during the rehabilitation phase and recovery phase of the community. The SWD usually holds cash for work, food for work activities, but this is only a thing that we do to facilitate their actual return to normalcy.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, apart from those that I've mentioned, we are also providing psychosocial interventions because we need to recognize that not all are actually equipped with mental instrumentalities to cope up with this trauma that they are experiencing. So kinakailangan nating i-explain sa kanila that this particular incident is only temporary, and of course eventually their lives will be will return to normal. But at present, our social workers who are deployed in the field are actually doing an assessment of their cases so that we could determine the appropriate interventions to be given to them. As mentioned also by Sir, eventually we will be providing cash for work in order for them to cope up with their economic requirements as well.
Okay, all right. But you have 30,000, right? Did you say 30,000 individuals?
Yes, 6,000 families or more than 30,000 individuals.
Okay. All of these evacuees are new evacuees, or they're evacuees from the previous earthquake?
Okay, we have accounted them as from the previous earthquake, which happened in October 16, 1617.
That's correct.
And then, it is a cumulative number already. And not all of these 6,000 families are actually in evacuation sites. Mm. Some of them have also relocated. Nakikitira ngayon sa mga families nila or relatives and friends, because we need to acknowledge that not all would like to reside in temporary shelters and above.
Yeah.
Yes. And apart from that, DSWD will also be providing the emergency shelter assistance. This is the provision of financial or material assistance to households or individuals whose houses are actually damaged partially or totally. So we are extending financial assistance and
of
the material or both. A maximum of 30,000. Mm-hmm. But this will depend on the assessment of our social workers. Aside from that, we are also providing emergency tents as temporary shelters, as I've earlier mentioned.
Okay. All right. Yes?
With regard to the reconstruction of homes, previously, Undersecretary Halad, with our NDRMC officials, visited some of the municipalities. The National Housing Authority issued financial assistance for the rebuilding of homes once the situation calms. Families that have been identified as with homes totally destroyed received 20,000 pesos as part of the support funding for reconstruction.
Okay. All right. Let's have a little history here. Well, unless I'm wrong, it seems the strongest quake that the Philippines has experienced was Baguio. Is that correct? Correct?
An intensity.
It was a 9. 7.9.
So 7.9. Is that correct that it was the strongest?
In my memory, I could say yes.
And that was the strongest damage, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. In history.
The most famous.
In Philippine history lang to.
Yes.
So the reason I'm asking this is because the reason why that was such a big story is, other than the magnitude of the damage and the deaths then, was it didn't happen often.
Correct.
In other words, an earthquake was big news. What's scarier today is it seems to be happening more often, is my point, wherein the magnitude isn't a 4 or a 5. So when the FEVOC says, you know, earthquakes happen every day, there are 20, 30 tremors, that would have been fine if the magnitude was 2 or 3 or 4. But now you have a 6.6 happening today. 3 days after, you have a 6.5. So there, the NDRRMC must make some kind of a new protocol for the country. Because it's different when an earthquake happens once in a while of that magnitude, and now you're seeing it more often.
Well, we have developed contingency plans, earthquake contingency plans.
Okay.
We have the one in Metro Manila in view of the big one. But in other municipalities, all regional disaster councils have required local governments to establish their own earthquake contingency plans. With regard to what you mentioned,
Because it is more often
the faults that are prevalently existing here in Luzon are longer faults. But the area in Mindanao that we're seeing now is that the faults are in close proximity to one another. That's why the movement of one affects the nearest faults. In Tulunan, there are a number of faults. That is why the movement of one has somehow pressured the nearest faults to be active as well. The ones here in Luzon, like what we have, the West Valley Fault, is quite long. It stretches from, if I'm not mistaken, San Jose del Monte, Bulacan, going down to Tagaytay or up to Laguna. And anywhere, any point of that fault can become the source of an earthquake. But because of its length, the energy gets dissipated immediately or in a shorter period of time compared to this close proximity faults. Hence, the occurrence of faults in a not so regular basis. Earthquakes in not so regular basis.
No, but I'm saying, are there new protocols or none yet? Given that the faults, the earthquake seems to be one after the other.
For example,
that's my question.
The Metro Manila Earthquake Impact Reduction, Metro Manila Earthquake Contingency Plan, or OPLAN Yakal Plus, identifies a protracted period of evacuation.
Yeah, don't be technical. So, are you saying?
What
are you saying, essentially?
We have made provisions.
What is the new plan?
We have made provisions of extended displacement.
So what are they? What are these, for example?
For example, Metro Manila will not be able to fully respond to the demands of the evacuation situation. So there will be other regions assisting Metro Manila, the provision of goods, rescue personnel, relief assistance, temporary shelters. And then if in cases we're in, these assistance provided by the different regions of the Philippines would prove insufficient to sustain the populations here in Metro Manila that had been displaced, we have entered into agreements in the ASEAN and the United Nations level for the provisioning of international assistance. So we have agreements with ASEAN, the ASEAN Disaster Management Agreement, for other ASEAN countries to provide assistance here. We also have created response depots containing relief items, not just here in Metro Manila, but also in the nearby provinces.
Okay. So what are people always missing when there's an earthquake? There's the duck cover
and hold
protocol already. But then what do people often forget that can cost them their lives?
Well, the presence of mind, because usually
that's a given. But what is it, what can they usually do that would have maybe helped them?
Well, during earthquakes, what I'm trying to say is you should do preparations before the actual emergency.
Okay, go on. All right.
This is usually what we forget, that preparedness is key for survival.
Okay, so what should they prepare for?
So, for example, personally, a person should always have the whistle, a flashlight, because if in case a building collapses, the whistle will assist the rescuers in locating where you are.
I think that's the best thing you've said, because that's so simple.
That's correct.
And yet can save your life.
Yes.
That nobody wants to carry a whistle every day, but you have to find a way that it's on your body.
Correct.
So maybe I was thinking
IDs,
maybe you could have it on your phone, like if you're a student, the keychain has a whistle on it.
Correct,
and then you
correct.
Said a flashlight.
Yes, a flashlight.
Okay, go on.
In cases where an earthquake would happen at night, there will be expected power interruption, so that you have the flashlight to guide you. Houses or each family member, if I may put it, should have their own disaster survival kits, go bags.
Thank you for watching. For more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.